Well, thank you everybody for coming this afternoon to our HRC Work in Progress or seminar series. My name is Professor Kylie Message. I'm head of the Humanities Research Centre at the ANU, and I'll be chairing our session this afternoon. I'd like to start by acknowledging and celebrating the first Australians on whose traditional lands we're meeting. I'm on unceded Ngunnawal and Ngambri lands, and I pay my respects to the elders past, present and emerging. Our speaker this afternoon is Dr. Gemma King. Gemma is a senior lecturer in French in the School of Literature, Languages and Linguistics here at the ANU. And she's also our 2021 RSHA Internal HRC Fellow. Unfortunately, I've seen Gemma in real life far less than I would normally with internal fellows and than I would normally like to do because of COVID, but she did manage to have a couple of weeks, I think, in our offices before she was swiftly moved back to home.
It was such a luxury.
Yeah, it was nice while it lasted. So Gemma's research focuses on contemporary cinemas and museums. She specialises in the representation of multilingualism, transnational connections, colonial histories, violence and social power. She is the author of monographs, Decentering France, Multilingualism and Power in Contemporary French Cinema by Manchester University Press from 2017, and Jacques Audiard, which was published in 2021, it as a volume in Manchester University Press's French Film Director series. So today Gemma's talk is titled Signs on Screen, Deafness and Sign Language in Contemporary Film. In the seminar, Gemma's going to explore how a range of sign language films radically interrogate received norms of culture and identity, how deaf groups use language and construct community, and what national language means for a nation that was always already multilingual. So I'm really looking forward to this talk tonight, and we'll have plenty of time for questions and comments and feedback after Gemma's presentation. As I said just before, these sessions tend to be more informal when we do them in person, and a bit less presentation-like as they are in Zoom. So we'll try and integrate a bit of interaction at the end, but we'll see how we go. So thank you all for coming, and over to you, Gemma.
Great. Thank you so much, Kylie. And thank you everyone for joining us. I'll just pop my screen up. Okay, so today I'll be discussing the power dynamics between majority and minority languages, and I'll be doing so in reference to deaf community and sign languages, but this is a dynamic that's essential to recognise in our own broader society, in the relationship between the colonial lingua franca of English and the over 200 native languages, including sign languages, used by Indigenous Australians. I acknowledge the Ngunnawal and Ngambri people on whose lands I live and work. I pay my respects to their elders past and present, and I honour their enduring resistance to linguicide and cultural hegemony. I also want to note that while this talk unfortunately doesn't include an Auslan interpreter, and I'm aware that there may be some deaf people in the audience, and if so, thank you so much for joining us. So I have activated the live captioning function, and this is a bit of an experiment to see if this technology is appropriate for this kind of presentation. Though I'm planning a series of public events which will include live Auslan interpreting. So thank you for being my guinea pigs while we see if this technology has value. I am trying to teach it to differentiate between deaf, D-E-A-F, and death, D-E-A-T-H, and sometimes it makes that unfortunate typo, so please bear with me. So in a COVID-19 and post-Black Summer era of government press conferences featuring an unprecedented use of Auslan interpreters, sign language and deaf experience are more present on our screens than ever before. Though deaf cultures and sign languages have always been a part of cinema history, 9 times more films and series in global sign languages have been released in the decade since 2011 than in any other decade in the preceding century. Pardon me. The screen is a privileged site for representing sign languages and for translating them to hearing audiences via subtitles. The auditory nature of cinema, with its capacity for cutting, muffling, and distorting sound, also allows hearing audiences to perceive deaf perspectives in immersive and even transformative ways. Screen texts can debunk myths, increase meaningful self-representation for deaf viewers, and provide a point of entry for hearing viewers to unlearn their assumptions and cultivate a deeper understanding of deaf language and culture. However, until the 21st century, screen texts depicting deaf characters and sign language were not only rare, but were rarely written, directed, or even acted by deaf people. More often than not, 20th century screen depictions of deafness and sign language perpetuated tropes of social isolation, medical pathology, and especially linguistic poverty. Oop. By contrast, since the 2010s, a radically new corpus has been appearing on transnational screens. From the US to Ukraine, from Australia to Japan, we're witnessing the growth of a vibrant sign screen culture. These films conceive of sign languages as complete and deaf culture as empowering. They also pose profound questions about community, national language, and domestic internal multilingualism in countries that proclaim to have perhaps only one national language. Based at the intersection of transnational studies, language studies, and film studies, my new research project, Signs on Screen, analyzes contemporary films and television series featuring sign languages to investigate how screen culture represents, authentically or otherwise, the diversity of deaf experience. Now I'm manifesting the typo. So today I'm aware that I won't be able to take you through the entirety of contemporary sign language cinema, but I can lead you through the most striking elements of this film movement. For context, I'm currently preparing an application for an Australian Research Council DECRA award, which is a 3-year research fellowship on this project. So I'm in the early stages of scouting out this corpus, tracing its evolution through film history, and drawing out the key lines of inquiry. Using the multilingual film methodology that I built in my first book, I'm combining quantitative studies of the production metadata of sign language films with qualitative film analysis of deaf narratives to trace the evolution of a minority film movement that is both current and expanding. I don't pretend to have all the answers at this stage, and I want to note outright the limitations of my own perspective as a hearing person conducting this work. I am studying Auslan, but I am not deaf. So I've shaped this project as a collaboration with colleagues at the Deaf Society of Australia, and I'll be working with them throughout the project. So today you'll get a slice of this broader project. I'll begin by defining the limits of this concept of sign language cinema. Then I'll present a broad overview of the 20th century precursors to this current movement, followed by the most emblematic or exciting examples of contemporary sign language cinema. I'll run through some of the guiding motifs and narrative tropes to be found in these films, and some of the ethical questions around representation that are at the heart of this corpus and the discussions it provokes. Finally, I'll focus in on 2 important case studies I've been working on as a kind of prototype during my residence here at the HRC, a subset of 2010s French sign language films. I've chosen these case studies for 2 reasons. The first is purely practical. This is a film culture that I know well, After all, I'm a scholar of contemporary French cinema, and this is where I first noticed the rise in sign language films. And so this is a logical place for me to start as I embark on what is effectively a global cinema project. But on a deeper level, French sign language cinema is particularly illuminating because of France's historical relationship with sign. Perhaps more than anywhere else in the world, France has a long history of public deaf representation and French sign language education. France was the first place to invent dedicated deaf schools in the 18th century, not coincidentally founded during the Enlightenment era and expanded during the linguistic unification of France after the revolution. In fact, the only deaf university in the world, Gallaudet University in Washington, DC, is named after the French sign language teacher, Thomas Gallaudet, who was poached from France in the 19th century to emulate the French deaf school system in the US. This is why French Sign Language and American Sign Language share many similarities even today. And if you're wondering, yes, British Sign Language was largely imported into Australian schools at the same time due to colonialism. And British Sign Language and Auslan still share many similarities, though they're absolutely different languages. However, Auslan is also significantly influenced by Irish Sign Language, partly due to the fact that early deaf schools in Australia, just like in France, were often Catholic. Despite these beginnings, from the late 19th to the late 20th century, France, like Australia, was the site of a widespread rhetoric of oralism. The Milan Conference of 1880, controlled almost solely by hearing people and organizations, led to the adoption of strict oralist policies in many deaf schools around the world. This meant deaf students were discouraged and often forbidden from using sign and taught to rely on lip reading and oral speech that they couldn't actually hear themselves. Antoinette Avon explains the oralist era's paternalist assumption that, quote, the oral method of instruction would be the way to restore the deaf to society and provide them with a greater knowledge of language. It's really only in the last few decades, and especially the 21st century, that these cultures have begun to recover from the effects of oralism, with sign language use increasing in schools, in public, and especially in screen culture. So zooming back out again, before I get into more detail, I want to clarify exactly what I mean by sign language cinema. For those who may not be aware, there are hundreds of different sign languages globally, which develop organically in geographic and cultural contexts, just as any other language does. Some sign languages are identified as national sign languages, such as French Sign Language or Japanese Sign Language, but there are also many variations in dialects, and it can be difficult to draw the line between the sign languages of some regions, such as in Eastern Europe. It's also important to acknowledge the wealth of Indigenous sign languages that are used across the world, for example, in Aboriginal Australia and in Turtle Island, North America. These sign languages are used with deaf community members, but they're also used much more broadly in the community as a part of everyday communication. Though the most common sign languages represented on screen are national sign languages used with deaf characters, I'm interested in all representations of all sign languages on screen. I'm also interested in the spectrum of deaf experience on screen. But there is never one way to be deaf. So deaf here comprises profound deafness or a complete lack of hearing, but also partial deafness, hearing aid use, cochlear implants, tinnitus, and deaf blindness, and all the other manifestations of deafness that are possible. You'll also notice throughout this presentation that I'm often capitalizing the word deaf. Deaf with a capital D refers to a culture and an identity, whereas deaf with a lowercase d refers to the physiological condition of not hearing. Deaf culture is central to deaf experience, and we'll explore several of its particularities in films today. And finally, I'm taking a lot of creative license in my definition of cinema. When I first began this project, I had rather naively assumed I would be looking at fictional feature films, the kind that would find their way into a physical cinema. But I quickly realized this was a false division and wouldn't do justice to the depth and breadth of sign language screen culture. Sign language spans the full spectrum of audiovisual production. And when I speak of cinema or film, I'm actually speaking in shorthand to encompass feature films, but also short fiction films, documentary features, documentary shorts, fictional TV series, reality TV shows, and occasionally even TikToks and YouTube videos. The biggest budgets go to the movies, of course, but sign language screen culture is proliferating in far more diverse environments, and this project will reflect that. We are currently witnessing the first wave of progressive sign language cinema. Sign language is appearing on our screens more than ever in history. Deaf actors and makers are more involved in screen projects than ever before. And the way in which deafness and sign languages are represented is rapidly evolving, and for the most part, improving. But it would be wrong to suggest that sign language cinema is new, because it's actually older than spoken language cinema. The first sign language films appeared in the silent era, when the US National Association for the Deaf, or NAD, released a series of short films in American Sign Language, or ASL. The most famous of these is the 1913 Preservation of the Sign Language, performed by NAD President George Viditz, which quickly became a famous speech among the deaf in favor of ASL use and protection of deaf culture more broadly. The NAD films were not intertitled, meaning they didn't have the explanatory text screens between scenes that were the norm of the silent era. And that's because they were aimed towards deaf viewers. This was a golden age of deaf filmmaking for the deaf. But this was a short-lived era. From the invention of the talkies in the 1930s, a steady number of films were produced in sign languages, mostly ASL in Hollywood. However, the forms of representation shifted dramatically from the deaf-led optimism of the NAD films. Occasionally, deaf characters were played by deaf actors, such as Marley Matlin's Oscar-winning turn in 1989's Children of a Lesser God. But for the most part, 20th century depictions of deafness and sign language tended to portray deaf characters as passive, tragic, or offensively humorous, often side characters, usually portrayed by hearing actors. And deaf experience was largely writ in terms of social and romantic isolation, physical danger and vulnerability, or perhaps most problematically, as a noble struggle away from the lonely, languageless world of sign towards civilization through the study of lip reading or verbal speech. This is also where we get a lot of deaf genre tropes that continue today. In 1932's The Man Who Played God, we have the first example of the tragedy of a talented musician whose passion is destroyed by the incursion of deafness. In 1948's Johnny Belinda, I think I found the oldest example of what is now a well-worn narrative of an isolated young deaf woman who is stalked and terrorized by a hearing man. And perhaps the most famous film on this screen is part of the beloved trope of the Helen Keller biopic. 1979's The Miracle Worker is just one of over a dozen films about the life of deafblind woman Helen Keller, which is, of course, a remarkable story, but also one that often leans heavily on narratives of civilizing the deaf through language. And we'll see another example of that today with the French film Marie Hortin, who is often referred to as the French Helen Keller. And in fact, just last week, it was announced that a new Helen Keller biopic is in the works in Hollywood, with Millicent Simmons, the deaf star of A Quiet Place, set to play Keller. And that announcement has kicked off a new round of debate about whether a deafblind actress should have been cast in that role. From the silent era to the end of the 2000s, I found 170 films, shorts, documentaries, and series in sign language. The vast majority of these are in American Sign Language. That's 170 films in 100 years. Not bad. Well, in the 11 years since 2010, there have been 100. That's a leap from 1.7 on average a year from 1913 to 2009 to 9 a year from 2010 on. In the 2010s and 2020s, deaf screen production is not only exploding in volume, it's also wildly diversifying in origin, with a huge rise in deaf filmmaking from East and South Asia, Europe and Australia, even if the US is still the largest producer. The participation of deaf filmmakers, actors, writers, producers and consultants is steadily increasing. And this is where we see perhaps the most significant change. The nature of deaf representation is also evolving. From the Australian unsound to the British the silent child, from the French la famille Bélier to the Japanese a silent voice, from the American A Quiet Place and A Quiet Place Part 2 to the Ukrainian the tribe, a vibrant screen culture is arising around deafness and sign language. This culture is not only the domain of art house filmmaking, but also appears in blockbuster productions. Fans like me of Disney's Star Wars series, The Mandalorian, may remember 2019's episode with the Tusken Raiders, whose sign language was created and portrayed by deaf actor Troy Kotsur. And just this weekend, I went to see Marvel's new superhero epic, Eternals. Don't waste your time. Which is being widely touted for featuring the first ever deaf superhero. Makari is the first deaf superhero in the Marvel or DC universes, but she's actually not the first deaf superhero. In 2013, Troy Kotsur himself directed a film called Super Deafy, a comedy about a deaf superhero. And the 2017 film Sign Genes includes a cast of deaf superheroes and deaf supervillains, Genes, G-E-N-E-S, who communicate in a mix of American, Italian, and Japanese sign languages. Not merely multi-sensory, this cinema is multilingual. It is also often intersectional in its centering of deaf characters who are also queer, as in Unsound and Deaf You, Black, as in Eternals, working class, as in La Famille Bélier and Coda, Indigenous, as in Godzilla versus Kong, if you can believe it, and female, as in A Quiet Place and Marie Arthur. However, they also often resist the categorization of deafness as a disability or disadvantage. These films cast deaf and other signing characters as active participants in their own narratives and imagine the many experiences of deafness, while often challenging, as valid and complete. In these films, sign can not only be the language of the family home, but of political organization and public activism. These films consider deaf community as a diverse society in which deafness is not experienced in terms of loss or lack. Instead, sign is an asset that affords access to emotional fulfillment, self-determination, and civic belonging. Both cultural and political, these texts abolish the historical myth of sign as languageless. They can even encourage us to imagine scenarios in which sign language can be more useful and more accessible than verbal language. For example, in the horror film A Quiet Place, American Sign Language is not only the primary form of communication for a family with a deaf daughter. When the world is invaded by murderous, hyper-hearing aliens who perceive their victims solely through the sounds they produce, sign becomes the key to their survival. Sign allows them to inhabit a quiet place. And eventually, spoiler warning, the deaf protagonist Regan repurposes her hearing aid and the feedback it produces near radio transmitters into a weapon to save her family. These films are not just fictional or didactic entertainment, but powerful cultural filters. They reconceptualize sign and deafness in terms of empowerment. So as you can see, this is a really diverse corpus that spans countries, genres, and languages. But there are some guiding motifs that continue to arise in many of these films. Firstly, they constantly return to questions of authenticity. This relates to whether or not deaf makers were included in the filmmaking, but also to the ethics of representing deafness in realistic ways and the dangers of perpetuating myths. For example, films such as Jacques Audiard's 2001 Read My Lips have been criticized for portraying lip reading as a straightforward, foolproof process. In reality, only about 30% of lip reading is intelligible. It may be surprising to learn that these films are also often about sound. There's the age-old tragic narrative of the musician who is slowly going deaf, and there are plenty of Beethoven films, but there's also The Sound of Metal from 2019, about a heavy metal drummer who's losing his hearing. And there are more creative films about music and sound, such as The Deaf Nightclub in the Auslan film Unsound, in which ravers play loud house music with a heavy bass line so they can dance to the vibrations. Another common theme is relationship barriers between deaf and hearing partners or family members, but also between deaf students and their hearing teachers, and even deaf defendants and their hearing lawyers. We also often see the portrayal of transitional or otherwise in-between identities, especially characters who are progressively losing their hearing, and coders, or children of deaf adults, CODA. The hearing children of deaf parents who eternally inhabit two worlds and often assume the literal in-between role of an interpreter. One of the most common genres in these films is horror. And for many rich and revealing reasons, the protagonists of these films are usually deaf women. But more and more often, these are actually subversive characters who use their knowledge and sign to turn the tables on their tormentors and even save others. All these motifs have their own subcorpus of films. But there's a final guiding motif of sign language cinema that I find particularly exciting. And to introduce this motif, I'm going to show a clip from the 2020 Netflix series Deaf U, the letter U. Made and presented like any other trashy, melodramatic reality show, Deaf U is set at Gayode University and explores the lives of a group of Gayode deaf undergraduates. I love this show so much. Deaf culture isn't simply the grouping together of deaf people, and it isn't a microcosm of hearing society. As this clip shows, deaf cultures arise from the organic development of a distinct linguistic community with its own histories, values and hierarchies. And at the summit of those hierarchies are those whose families have been deaf for generations and for whom sign language is their mother tongue. Many sign language films construct their characters within complex and vibrant deaf communities, which also find themselves at odds with the broader norm, or call into question ideas about how homogenous any particular society can be or ever was. And this is the strand I'd like to pick up in the time that remains. You can see here a range of French sign language films, produced roughly between the late 90s and today. France is the second largest producer of sign language cinema globally after the US. The most influential FSL films actually both came out in 2014, and I'm not sure if that was a coincidence yet, but there were many deaf films produced globally that year. The first was Jean-Pierre Améris's Marie Hortin and Éric Lartigot's La Famille Bélier. Marie Hortin is based on a true story in 1880s rural France near Poitiers and tells the story of a deaf blind girl, Marie, and her teacher, Marguerite. La Famille Bélier is set in the contemporary era and tells the story of the teenage Paula, who is torn between her duties on her parents' dairy farm in Normandy and her dream of pursuing a singing career. The two films obviously differ in topic and era, but they're very alike in setting and theme. A closed rural community in picturesque northwest France, far from any cities or hubs of multiculturalism, in what Mary Harrod and Phil Powery have described as discreet and conservative French communities. These are far from what Mary Louise Pratt calls language contact zones, far from borders or cosmopolitan spaces. And yet these are fundamentally bilingual places. For both Marie Hertin's Marguerite and La Famille Bélier's Paula are coders, hearing children born to deaf parents. Paula is the only hearing person in a family with a deaf mother, father, and brother, and Sister Marguerite is one of the few hearing nuns in a school for deaf children. Both these films include as much sign language as they do French. I think that Marie Hortin actually may be majority sign. And their hearing protagonists are the minority in their majority deaf surroundings. Each of these films is set in the rural French heartland, yet they both construct a multilingual world within the contours of the French nation state. Thus, they radically interrogate received norms of culture and identity, how deaf groups use language and construct community, and what national language means for a nation that was already multilingual. La Famille Bélier was an enormous commercial success, with 7.5 million tickets sold in France and earning $82 million worldwide. It was the second highest grossing film of 2014 in France, despite only coming out in December of that year. It was also nominated for 5 Césars, the French equivalents of the Oscars, including Best Film. However, despite its success, La Famille Bélier also garnered controversy for the casting of hearing stars Karin Viard and François Damiens in the roles of Paula's deaf parents. In her scathing article entitled La Famille Bélier is Yet Another Cinematic Insult to the Deaf Community, Rebecca Atkinson criticizes the film for perpetuating a long history of hearing actors misrepresenting deafness in ways that have been likened to pantomime and even blackface. The film's 2021 American remake, Coda, dodges these problems, casting deaf actors in all the deaf roles. And you can watch Coda on Apple TV for free. It's really good. La Famille Bélier was quite unique at the time for its portrayal of a deaf family dramatic comedy, rather than a melodrama or tragedy. The narrative crux of the film is the hearing Paula's secret dream of wanting to be a singer, which would involve her leaving the family farm and her role as the family's interpreter to study music in Paris. The main narrative tension is Paula's guilt at wanting to leave her family, her concern that they won't be able to do business on their own, and their struggle to understand her passion. Here you can see her father, Rodolphe, trying to appreciate Paula's singing by placing a hand on her vocal cords. But what I find most interesting in this film, apart from the casting issues, is the subplot, which involves Rodolphe running for local public office. A salt of the earth farmer with traditional family values, Rodolphe quickly finds an audience for his campaign. because his priorities align with many other struggling farmers in the region, hearing farmers. Rodolphe relies on Paula to interpret his speeches for the media and the broader public, but he's running for office not because of his deafness, nor even despite it as a challenge to himself, but simply because he wants to advance the economic and social values of his local community. La Famille Bélier paints a fascinating portrait of ways in which deaf people can occupy a place in hearing communities. Coda reimagines this dynamic as even more community-focused by transplanting the family business to a New England fishing community and having the deaf father and son start a co-op among the local fishers. But perhaps more compelling is the portrait of community that we see in Marie Hurtin. In the pastoral tranquility of a 19th century Catholic school for deaf girls, a child arrives whose inability to see or hear will test the school's sisters, who teach sign language with ease to the deaf, but not the deaf-blind. Though Marie Hurtin, played by deaf actor Ariana Rivoire, is the subject of the film, the true protagonist is her teacher and carer, Sister Marguerite. Played by Isabelle Carré, Marguerite is a seeing and hearing nun who feels called to bring Marie forth from what she calls her nuit en silence, or silent night, by teaching her French sign language using touch. Like Paula, Marguerite is a coda, and for the better part of a year, she struggles to educate Marie, who appears to be calmed by her presence, but unable to understand that Marguerite's hand movements, guiding Marie to touch objects before shaping her hands to create the sign for them, are designed to convey semantic meaning. Marie Hurtin's narrative focus is on the challenge of educating a deafblind child. However, the film's radical contribution is not so much its representation of the profoundly othered Marie, but the supposedly normal society which surrounds her. Oralist discourse of the late 19th to late 20th century, which did enormous damage to deaf culture and language across the Western world, used the rhetoric of civilization to argue that sign language was not language and that deaf people must learn oral speech to comprehend complex ideas and participate in society. Sign was also interpreted as a threat to national cohesion, whereby there must be only one domestic national language. Antoinette Avon writes, and I quote, "Language works to unite people within specific boundaries. Those supporting oralism were not concerned with the deaf person's ability to function in the greater society. Rather, the educators of the time were more concerned with national unity." So Marguerite and her colleagues use much of this civilizing vocabulary to discuss Marie's need to, quote, learn language in order to enter the world. But this civilized world is not one of vocal speech, but of sign. By far the most frequently used language in the school is French Sign Language. Many of the school's nuns are deaf, as are all of its students, and it appears that the only nun unable or unwilling to sign is the Mother Superior herself, who is often portrayed as being disconnected from the practical and emotional needs of her charges. Marguerite and Mother Superior are the two characters with the most power and authority in the film, yet their hearing abilities are not coded as giving them any particular advantage or insight in the context of the school. French Sign Language is so normalized, it's barely even referred to among the characters. And the distinction between spoken French and French Sign Language is often blurred, with the verb parler, to speak, used to describe both. And this is made clear in a revealing scene in which Marguerite tries to convince Mother Superior to allow her to teach Marie sign.
Ma mère, je ne destinais pas à l'éducation et c'est vrai que je me sens mieux à travailler de mes mains. Mais hier, quand j'étais en haut de cet arbre, je me suis trouvée en face de cette jeune fille. J'arrive pas à penser à ma mère.
Mais vous n'avez aucune expérience avec les sourdes.
Je les côtoie depuis 8 ans, j'ai appris à parler leur langue.
Mais les côtoyer, c'est une chose, et les sortir de leur silence en est une toute autre. En plus, ces pauvres étaient aveugles.
Laissez-moi au moins essayer. J'ai eu une révélation.
Une révélation?
Enfin, pas une révélation. Je veux dire, juste une idée. Oui, c'est ça, une simple idée. Je peux me tromper, hein, mais si je me trompais pas, si ma mission c'était de m'occuper de cette pauvrette, comme vous dites, et de lui offrir la parole pour qu'elle puisse entrer dans le monde des hommes et de Dieu.
Non.
Mais...
Vous m'avez parlé, je vous ai écouté, vous m'avez posé une question et je vous réponds non.
Merci, ma mère. Permettez-moi d'insister, ma mère, cette jeune fille ne peut pas rester comme ça, enfermée dans sa prison. Quelqu'un doit l'en sortir. Quelqu'un doit lui apprendre à parler.
Et comment vous, vous y prendriez-vous?
La langue des signes.
Mais elle est aveugle.
Tu ferais les signes dans la main.
Cette petite est sourde et aveugle de naissance. À force, son intelligence s'est certainement raccordée.
Oui, mais si son intelligence est restée intacte, cette intelligence doit énormément souffrir d'être emprisonnée. Même s'il n'y a qu'une chance infime pour que ce soit le cas.
Oui, s'occuper d'une enfant pareille est un travail considérable. Et avec vos problèmes de santé...
Mes poumons causeront certainement ma mort, mais enfin d'ici là...
C'est déjà un miracle que vous soyez encore en vie. Enfin, miracle. Non, pas un miracle, mais...
I hope that wasn't too jolty. Okay. When Marguerite describes Marie's potential to speak, she really means to sign. For sign is the school's and the film's lingua franca, accessible to all its characters in ways that spoken French is not. Indeed, when the sister Raphael, pictured here, describes how the world opened up to her when she learned to speak, she describes moving from silence to language. She signs, "I lived in silence until I was 4. My parents didn't know sign language." For Raphael, silence is not sonic, but ontological. And the arrival of sign language in her life ruptured this oppressive silence in a way that no verbal language ever could. This is a far cry from the reductive criticisms of oralism. Many cliches of earlier cinema revolve around assumptions of deafness as equating to both isolation and powerlessness. In direct contrast, in Marie Hortin, sign language is social, connective, and empowering. This positioning of French Sign Language as the lingua franca of a diverse French community, not all of whom are actually deaf, disrupts monistic notions of national language. It also troubles the xenophobic othering that haunts so much discourse around multilingualism, which is made explicit in the very term foreign language, denoting a language which arrives on, say, French territory from somewhere beyond. Because sign language used in this community is domestic language, it's a French language, one which exposes the myth of a monolingual French-speaking France from within. To conclude, this project asks how contemporary cinema represents deafness, how sign language operates on screen, and what screen culture can tell us about deaf experience in the contemporary world. Among many other things, the representation of deaf community in sign language cinema shows us how these are complete and discrete sub-communities. Showing the multilingualism that has always existed in society, they call into question the predominance of that so-called national language. Much like multilingual Indigenous Australia, sign languages show us that beyond globalization, beyond immigration, beyond even colonization, the notion of a homogenous monolingual nation was always already a myth. Deaf language and culture have always been present in our societies, and we're finally seeing that reflected in authentic and complex ways on screen. Thank you.
Thanks, Gemma. That was a really extremely interesting and wide-reaching presentation. I'm sure people have some questions. There's already one in the Q&A. Briefly, if you do have a question that you'd like to ask Gemma, please put it either in the Q&A box or else in the chat box, and I will ask it on your behalf. So we've got a really excellent first question from an anonymous attendee. Have you found a perceivable difference between the reception of films featuring Coda as main protagonists as compared with films featuring deaf protagonists? Does it reflect a hearing society bias toward protagonists that represent hearing people?
It's a really excellent question. Depending on how optimistic I'm feeling on a given day, I could answer a simple yes to that second question. I think that it is really a deliberate choice to choose Coda as the guiding protagonist in a lot of these films, partly because they provide a kind of cultural bridge for a majority hearing audience. So an important thing to acknowledge is that these films, especially the sort of large budget feature films, are catering to a majority hearing audience. And they may be doing so with the best of intentions, but there are often sort of narrative and dialogic choices made to make it particularly accessible for hearing audiences, even if there are subtitles for all of the sign language. That said, one of the most important and successful and widely circulated and awarded films in sign language is a 2014 film called The Tribe, which is a Ukrainian film entirely in Ukrainian sign language. So there's no Ukrainian, there's definitely no English, and there are no subtitles. So you're immediately kind of plunged into this really disorienting and in fact isolating experience of trying to work out what is happening between the characters but not understanding a single thing. And so I actually think that film is a little bit controversial or potentially damaging in that it represents deafness as isolating by attempting to isolate the hearing audience. But it does show that people are willing to engage with deaf-only productions, and there is some curiosity around being taken out of our comfort zone, I think, for a lot of hearing audiences.
Thanks, Gemma. We have another comment or question from Malcolm Gillies. Many thanks, Gemma, for a hugely informative talk. You mentioned cochlear at one stage. A growing percentage of Australia's deaf people are now cochlear assisted and seem not to be learning sign languages. Is an appropriate cinematic literature developing to reflect their recent experiences?
Yes, and a really interesting text for that dynamic between perhaps what we might call profound deafness and even deaf people who use hearing aids versus those who use cochlear implants. Often we see a real criticism of cochlear implant users by deaf characters. So that clip that I showed you from Deaf You, the reality show on Netflix, which is so illuminating, it's really worth watching if you can handle the trashiness. That elite group, the super deaf group, the generationally deaf group, speak really disparagingly of those who use cochlear implants in the show. And it's something that comes up in quite a lot of films as well. But despite that controversy, that a lot of these films also really try to engage with the experience of those who have cochlear implants and how it can often be sort of doubly isolating when you don't fully belong in the hearing community and you don't fully belong in the deaf community. So in terms of a literature, in terms of scholarship, no, there's nothing, but the films themselves are engaging with it.
Okay, a couple more questions. One is, how will the deaf community be involved in this project going forward?
That's a great question. So we've developed an official partnership with the Deaf Society, where I'm learning Auslan. And so the Deaf Society will liaise with me. If this grant comes through, there'll be funding for a deaf PhD candidate to undertake a project on Australian sign language cinema and representations of Auslan on screen. And so they'll help me to find a suitable deaf or coda candidate to take on that project. And then every event that we have going forward, unlike this one, will have live Auslan interpreting, which is really important. So I'm very aware of that. And we're also going to structure, the project as sort of a combination of academic events and public screenings with Q&As and discussions, so that deaf community can be invited to engage either academically or publicly as a cultural discussion. So we're going to invite a number of deaf facilitators on board to lead those discussions. And I also have plans for an online film club to be run in Auslan for deaf community. And that's a really great point. Someone's just said the subtitles off. They came from the PowerPoint. So I wonder if I could just put the PowerPoint screen up. Do you mind, Kylie, the conclusion?
No, that's fine. Yep.
And that way we can still have.
Okay, we'll see how this works.
Right, okay. So I'm so sorry about that. The subtitles were attached to the PowerPoint and not the Zoom. So we're back.
So Gemma, you might need to ask the question, from the final question in the Q&A, because it looks like it's only picking up your voice, not my voice.
Oh, sure. Okay. So I will just handle that last question. I wonder what you make of the distinction between films about deaf protagonists or deafness, such as Marie Hortin, as opposed to films with deaf protagonists in them, such as John Wick or Four Weddings and a Funeral. It's an important one. How will they fit into the project? I'm actually especially interested in the films that aren't about deafness, but that represent deaf people, in the way that I talked about La Famille Bélier and the father's motivations for running for public office, not having anything to do with their deafness. The Australian film Unsound that you see here is a really interesting example of that. The film is about the main character's deafness in important ways. There's a lot of Auslan used and they work in a deaf community centre. But the main narrative focus is actually their trans identity. So it's largely about the relationship between a Black English man and a trans Australian man, navigating that relationship in a way that is actually not deeply impacted by the main character's deafness. So that, you know, we've got the whole spectrum of films that often are quite politically motivated and want to explore the details of deaf experience. And there's also another movement of wanting to just simply normalize deafness on screen as not necessarily the most important thing in a character's life. So it's about combining those two polarities.
We've probably got time for that last question from Robert. Gemma, if you'd like to read that one out.
Sure. Just wondering if there are any filmmakers, artists, screen-based media creators who use other sensory experiences to augment their work for deaf audiences. Perhaps those fancy cinemas with seats that shake and vibrate might exaggerate the felt experience of screen-based presentations. I would be interested to know that as well. As you know, this is an early stage. I haven't come across anything so far as far as augmented reality cinema experiences. I wouldn't be surprised if they exist. I think what's particularly interesting in a lot of these texts is the focus on vibration. A lot of them talk about feeling sound. We had that example of the father holding the daughter's vocal cords while she was singing. In unsound, they rave to house music because they can feel the bass line. And in Eternals, actually, I really rolled my eyes at this scene, but there is a scene where Makari is navigating a deal with some dodgy traders, and she turns away from them and they say, let's swindle her, let's trick her. And she turns around and says, I can feel the vibrations when you speak. I know you're trying to manipulate me. So sometimes it kind of gets lifted into ridiculous territory, although she is a superhero. But the texts themselves engage with other sensory perception alongside sound.
Okay, terrific. Thank you so much for everybody for asking questions. And thank you so much to Gemma for... I'm just going to put a comment in the text box so everybody is able to read it. But thank you so much, Gemma, for that really, really engaging and interesting talk. Thank you very much, everybody, for coming. The last public event we have coming up is Professor Simone Dennis from a new talking about Mary Douglas's 1966 book, Purity and Danger, an analysis of concepts of pollution and taboo. So quite a different topic. That's on 25th of November at 5 p.m. and hopefully everybody can join us then. Thank you, Gemma. Excellent, thanks everybody, have a great night.